without further ado, I'll introduce our third speaker. So Dr. David Patterson, coming and talking to us around nuclear medicine, both in terms of imaging but also in terms of treatment. So please join me in welcoming David.
Two speakers who've come before me to step around for my discussion about, particularly about molecular imaging or PET scanning and its role in imaging and neuroendocrine tumours, and also PRT, peptide receptor radionuclide therapy. Okay, so we're ready to go now. So in my background, is I'm dual trained. I did training as a nuclear medicine physician and also as an endocrinologist. I was working down at Peter Mac in Melbourne about the last 5 years, and then I've just moved up here to Brisbane. And I'm coming up to the first year anniversary in October. And so thoroughly enjoying the time of year, certainly enjoying the climate in southern Brisbane. I'm going to try and also keep things reasonably simple. As David's alluded to before, I'm an endocrinologist, so I'll keep it very simple, but also try and focus on some pictures for everybody. But basically, you know, principle, and this is a word that's talked about a lot these days, which is theranostics, which is really being able to predict the response to a therapy, which is the thera, the first part of the term, by using a diagnostic test. And it leads to what's been termed as personalised medicine. And this little example is how, you know, someone initially has a scan. In this case, we're talking about a PET scan, which sends off a signal with an image where disease might be in the body. And then if the signal's expressed, like this red dot here, if that was the tumour, you can then just change the kind of therapy, change, in this example, the radiation that's attached to that compound. You know where it's going to go, it delivers that targeted therapy, and then we go back to that imaging test that you can use to see, did it have a response or not? If it did have a response, you can do further scans in the future, see a good result. But if it happens to return again, you can use the same therapy again. And at the start, one of the other key benefits is that if that target isn't expressed in this patient, then of course we avoid the need of giving them, you know, potentially futile therapy. You can look at something that may well work. In terms of neuroendocrine tumours, which is what we're talking about tonight, so as previously mentioned, there's a lot of different sites, including the lung, gastroenteropancreatic system, so in the gut, but there are other, you know, rare sites. There are neuroendocrine types of thyroid cancer that can also occur in the adrenal glands and several other regions. This is from a similar study that Dave was talking about earlier, but there is the point that with neuroendocrine tumours, particularly the gastroenteropancreatic neuroendocrine tumours, which is either from the gut or from the pancreas, a diagnosis, unfortunately, is relatively common that they can have actually spread in up to 50% of cases. And this is where having a good, you know, staging test to identify if the tumour is just in the one spot where it can be surgically removed, or if it has spread more widely such that it couldn't be resected, is really important and valuable. And there has been some change in the imaging techniques that have been available over the last 20 years or so. And so this is just, you know, what we do is, down the bottom, this is an example, it's a diagram of the way we do this test. And as I try to explain to patients, we have this peptide, which is actually just a tiny bit of radioactive, well, it's just a tiny bit of octreotide, actually, is what the DOTATATE is. And we can attach a radioactive compound to that that emits these, you know, gentle rays that can be picked up on a PET scanner. And when we use this combination of these, of this compound, we can image very accurately where those somatostatin receptors are, which can be used either for treatment with octreotide, what we call cold octreotide, performed in injection, or you can, you know, change that radiation from an imaging tracer to one that emits, you know, intense radiation, and that's what the PRT is. But, you know, there has been evolution in the past. There's what's called the octreotide scan. This is a test that the government funds. This is the only funded test for imaging people with neuroendocrine tumours. The only nuclear medicine test, I should say. But that's evolved over time to get this sort of 3D representation of something called SPECT. And there's SPECT CT, where you add a CT, you can see in a bit more detail where it is. And then more recently, and it's been around for about the last 10 years or so, is where we can use a PET contrast and get far better, you know, imaging resolution of where the disease is. And this is just the example of those two cases. It was actually the same patient who had this test first when they presented, and they thought it was just in one spot, in the nose up here, in the neck. But then they subsequently came and had this, the newer GATAC scan, or gallium dotatate scan, which is the PET scan version. And then when that was done, it clearly showed that there were a lot more spots than were initially identified. And so the patient didn't end up having surgery, as was initially planned as a result of that. But, so you can clearly see lots of small little spots. And there's several differences between these tests, as we've talked about. This dotatate scan, which is certainly used at the Royal Brisbane, and certainly most around most of the big hospitals around Australia, the capital cities, have got access to this scan. In fact, Australia is very fortunate that it's very widely available here. In the US, it's only just become available in a few specialised centres in the last year or so. This test, it's easier for the patient. It's all done in about an hour, rather than the traditional triage scan, where people have to wait for up to 48 to 72 hours coming back from multiple imaging. But one of the issues until now, well, it still isn't funded, but fortunately, just in the last few months, the government's actually made an initial recommendation that it will become a funded scan, and so, there's hope that perhaps in the next year's budget that may be resolved, because it makes sense, because this test is actually over two times as expensive as the better one, so hopefully that will come through. In terms of the reasons why we do the scan, there's really four main reasons. The first one I mentioned earlier, that's at staging. So that's if there's a spot somewhere and it's felt to be just in one location, so someone's planning to have a major operation to remove it, that's the time when this test is often done. There are other times, particularly with patients who go and see an endocrinologist, who might have a hormonal syndrome, and it's a matter of trying to identify the source where it's coming from. It can be very, very hard with conventional imaging, but that's a common indication for localization of those spots. It can also be done for what we talked about earlier, this theranostic reasons, where you're doing it to see the intensity and distribution of those receptors throughout the body, to see if you can treat someone with PRT. And it can be used also restaging after any of the treatments we've talked about. If it does express the receptors, it can be used in that context. I'm not really going to dwell much on actual cases. This is just brief examples of, this is someone who had they were suspected to be causing this hormone, causes the syndrome, makes people put on a lot of weight, but it couldn't be found where the source was. In this case, fortunately, was able to find there was just a tiny spot, on the lung that you could see. You couldn't see it on the CT beforehand, but when you knew where to look from the PET scan, it was able to localise that. And so there are a couple of rare tumours. This is another very rare tumour that can be very hard to find otherwise, but can be picked up because they do express these receptors. So these are, rare, particular individual cases, but just sort of point out that there are a variety of roles where it can be useful. There are a number of these molecular imaging tests that can be used in neuroendocrine tumours. I'm not going to go through them in great detail. If you did need to have one of these scans, your oncologist or your treating doctor would likely be aware of the right test for you. So EFDOBA can be used in people with pheochromocytomas, which is a kind of tumour that makes adrenaline as a hormone. Same with MIBG scans are similar. And these are just using different characteristics of the tumour cell to help to localise in the body. We've talked about radioactive or radiolabeled triatide, things like dotatate PET that I mentioned. For people who've got a rare tumour that causes initial melanoma, there's a new test which is available for that at very selected locations. And we also use a different kind of test, which is just radioactive sugar that can look at what the sugar usage is within the tumour spots. And this is a different way of looking at, sort of in tandem, to characterise different elements of the tumour. And this is important because there is, in all tumours nowadays, but it's been particularly well characterised with neuroendocrine tumours, that not all of the tumour sites are actually the same. You know, some sites can be growing faster than others, some sites can be more indolent, and so that, you know, it is purely one biopsy is certainly helpful, but sometimes doing these other tests in specific circumstances can help direct a biopsy. I mean, we do know from several big studies that people who do have this increased sugar usage in the tumour sites, it does tend to mean that they are more aggressive compared to those that aren't using much sugar. So that can be used in certain circumstances to identify those different elements. This is a really extreme example of a case where this patient had a kind of pancreatic tumour that had spread throughout the body. And it was a tumour that was making a lot of it was making a lot of insulin. It made the patient's blood sugar levels go quite low. But this just demonstrates, you know, the point that we talked about. And this is it only happens in a rare minority of cases. It's this extreme. For most, it's much more subtle. But in this patient, if you looked on the sugar scan or FDG PET scan through this spot through the pancreas, you see that it's using a lot of sugar. It's very red on that scan. But at the same spot, this is the same patient, they had the gallium dotatate PET scan. And you could see that there really wasn't very much of that uptake at that site. But if you look at the difference, and if you did a biopsy there, that would probably have quite a high, we've talked about this Ki-67 index, it would probably be quite a high reading at that point. But if you go to a different level, and this time it's looking through the liver, it's sort of actually quite the opposite. And this has been termed what's called a flip-flop phenomenon. You can get different sites of tumour. And at this point, this one didn't use very much sugar at all, but it was expressing a lot of the somatostatin receptors at that point. And so this is sort of, you know, useful information that can be used to really characterise without even necessarily, I mean, obviously we like to confirm this by putting in a needle before we, to actually test it directly before changing the management, but it can help patients, you know, direct their treatment. And in this case, it was able to, because you could see that those sites that were that were expressing those somatostatin receptors were more likely to be making the insulin, and it led to those sites being targeted and it had a good response for this patient in that they were able to reduce the insulin secretion and resolve their issue, which was low blood sugar levels. And it was directly by the results of that imaging was able to direct that. The other point of using those two tests is when you talk about PRT, which is this radionuclide treatment, which I'll talk in more detail soon, we use the two combination of those scans, not in everyone, but in selected patients we use both scans, because in that case, giving PRT, because it wouldn't target all those sites of disease, it wasn't felt to be a suitable treatment. And these are the main reasons or main indications for doing these FDG or sugar scans. It's in those patients who've got this Ki-67 index, it's suggesting it's the biopsy suggests that it was a higher grade tumour that might be growing faster. Or if there's a particular reason from looking at the CT component of that dotatate PET scan, if there were spots that seemed to not be taking up a tracer, then the doctor reporting the scan might think, well, possibly that won't be targeted, maybe we should do this other scan to look at it more closely. And also in some patients where just the nature of the disease, things are progressing faster than would have been anticipated. And in this context, if something was progressing in sort of less than 6 months, while imaging or the way the patient's symptoms were progressing, that would be another problem to think, well, maybe we should look at doing this scan instead. But for the majority of patients, we wouldn't do this test. And this just leads to an ability to sort of characterise using those two tests where required. The different lower grade tumours tend to have more of this uptake on the dotatate PET, higher grade tumours tend to have more of the FDG uptake or the sugar usage, and it can help to guide treatment for patients. The peptide receptor radionuclide therapy, so this is when we saw that diagram earlier where it showed that we take some radioactive, we take some octreotide and we can attach some radiation to that, well, we can switch it. Instead of being an imaging kind of radiation, we can use a radiation that delivers quite intense radiation within about 1 to 2 millimeters of red lines in the body. this is just, I guess, an example of that. It's got some T-cells that are biased to that receptor, gets internalized, and then delivers some radiation nearby within about 1 to 3 millimeters. I'm just going to skip over this case. And just move on to earlier this year, in January, there was a really large randomized controlled clinical trial that was published in a big medical journal. I haven't gone through the trial in great detail, but essentially they took patients who had small bowel urinary tumors, so particularly the type similar to the myelocarcinoma carcinoma syndrome, that had spread throughout the body. And these people had already been on octreotide injections, but they reached a point where the tumours had started to grow despite that treatment. And at that point, they said, well, half of the people, we're going to put you on sort of double dose or very high dose of octreotide to try to control it. There have been some thoughts that may be effective. And the other half of the people, they randomly said, well, we're going to give you lutate therapy 4 cycles in a specific setting. And in similar to other studies we've seen before, there's really a marked prolongation of what's called a progression-free survival. So people, half the people on the high dose of octreotide, their disease, things progressed in about 8 or 9 months. Then the other group, after nearly 30 months, not quite half of the people progressed yet. So it really was quite a dramatic finding. It's very effective, particularly in this group with small bowel urinary tumours. And there still needs further analysis, but it suggests that it also actually increases overall survival as well. In terms of the main indications that we use, this is an old slide, but basically patients who've got their tumours that can't be resected, so the disease is spread or it's inoperable, they have uptake on the on a DOTATATE scan that's more than the liver, showing that there's enough uptake in the tumours to be treated and it's not going to cause undue side effects. You also don't want to have any evidence of disease that's using a lot of sugar that isn't going to be targeted, like that case I showed earlier. And then, additional factors of people having other symptoms that aren't being controlled, or particularly if the disease is such that there's been some growth over a 12-month period despite other conventional treatments. In terms of, there's only a few reasons why, if someone was otherwise suitable, that you would say not to go ahead. One is if there's low levels of something called albumin, which basically means someone's liver function isn't adequate to tolerate the treatment, and really severe kidney function, or very low platelet counts, or evidence of pre-existing problems with the blood counts that may lead to issues or too much toxicity from the treatment. But overall, it's a very well tolerated treatment. People can have transient nausea or discomfort, particularly over the first week or two after the treatment's given. At sites of where disease are, and that's because of radiation causing damage at those sites. It can also cause fatigue. This particularly occurs over the first month or so after each treatment. But they're very well tolerated, and on the whole, they're pretty mild side effects. The main things that people worry about, and why you wouldn't give it to obviously to everyone, is that about 1 to 2% of people can severely damage the bone marrow and cause like a second bone marrow cancer. It's rare and tends to happen years down the track, but you need to be certain that someone warrants treatment with this with PRT. And the other thing is sometimes people whose tumours do make hormones, there can be a bit of a flare in that as the tumour's cells are damaged, they can release more of these hormones. And so particularly in the first couple of weeks, cause problems. And so the main thing is in selected cases, and these are quite rare tumours, doctors need to be aware of that, pay particular attention and follow up more closely. In terms of the practical information about PRT and I guess a bit of an overview of a patient journey, when patients are deemed suitable, so the scans are discussed at the multidisciplinary meeting, and if on weighing up the balance of all the available treatments, if the MDT felt that the PRT was a suitable treatment for that particular patient, and then be referred down to nuclear medicine, and then we'd see a member of the team down there, one of the nuclear medicine physicians, myself and my colleagues. People would have a kidney test first, just to make sure it was accurate sure that that was adequate, and then review the imaging, discuss potential side effects, you know, be particularly certain that it was appropriate to use this treatment, sign a consent form, and one of the things that we do is when people are having some anesthetic analogs such as octreotide or lanreotide, to withhold those for 4 weeks before the treatment, so it's important patients and their treating doctors are aware of that. And overall, when it's decided to be administered, there are four cycles that are given, generally about 8 weeks apart, and each of these involves a day admission in the hospital, cannulas put into the arm, or drips put into the arm. People have an infusion of what's called amino acids, which is it's just basically a fluid that runs in over an hour, doesn't have any side effects, and it's run out over 4 hours. So within that over 15-minute period, people will have the infusion of the lutate. Very few people have any side effects at all during that period. You know, probably less than 10% might feel a bit nauseous and slow down the rate of infusion. And then following that, we'll have a post-treatment scan and discussion and consultation with the medicine physician. And most patients find that's quite a good opportunity to discuss their case and actually also to have a look at in quite detail at their actual scans as well. And then following the completion of the treatment, people will maintain follow-up with their oncologist throughout that period, and certainly thereafter that treatment episode, come back to see us again unless there was a need for further treatment or that has been considered. So, yeah, thank you. In terms of the weekly medicine side of things in the PRT, it really is, well, the whole thing is a big team effort, but, you know, in order to deliver the treatment, it requires nuclear medicine physicians, half of the nursing staff, so we've got Steve and Notch over here, who works sort of tirelessly really to help maintain and supervise this, those who are involved in the treatment, would certainly know his name and what he does. Then we have nuclear medicine technologists who are involved in doing the imaging, a radiochemist who manufacture the treatment, and our medical physicists are involved in doing a lot of dosimetry and other work. So thank you.